Hello, everybody, and welcome back to another exciting edition of Boyographic, a show in which I, Matt, the Game Boy, talk you through the highs and lows of the Game Boy library, one cart at a time. As tis the season, let's look at Avenging Spirit. Halloween. The one holiday where I know the Game Boy library has me covered for a topical trip into the world of the macabre. Thematically, at least, the Game Boy is host to more horror titles than any other system I know. Well, bar maybe the PS2. You got your sci-fi horror covered with games based off Lawnmower Man and Alien 3, your gothic horror in the system's three Castlevania games, not to mention a ton of games that take things you'd associate with Halloween itself, like monsters, ghosts, and demons, that can easily scratch that itch as well. Some of these dial up the cuteness, while others choose to embrace a more serious tone. Either way, if October 31st is your thing, the Game Boy's got you covered. However, the game we're looking at this Halloween is, perhaps when you really analyse it, the most sinister game on the system. For you see, Jaleco's Avenging Spirit is a game about murder, demonic possession, and revenge. Not that you get that from looking at the game's box art necessarily, but we're getting ahead of ourselves. To begin talking about Avenging Spirit, we need to look to the arcades. In 1991, a studio called CP Brain developed a two-player arcade platformer called Phantasm for Jaleco, a name for horror movie fans it obviously didn't keep when coming to Western shores. Avenging Spirit, as the game would be renamed, sees you play as the spirit of a murdered boy on a mission to save your girlfriend who has been kidnapped by the Mafia. Why, you might ask? Well, because her father is a ghost scientist, and the Mafia wants his research. If it wasn't clear from the chunky sprites and interesting enemy roster, Avenging Spirit is a game with some pretty serious themes, wrapped up in the same comical, chibi tones as Kid Dracula. You battle through 6 levels, avoiding pit traps, possessing enemies, and beating end-of-level bosses in an attempt to save the girl. Though, if I'm totally honest, as much as I love the look and feel of CP Brain's arcade adventure, I've always thought that platforming mechanics were a little too floaty and enemy placement a little too cheap to ever sing the game's praises as much as I do the games Jaleco developed in-house. But we're not here to talk about the arcade game, really, are we? On a system where arcade ports are dime a dozen, is Avenging Spirit a classic coin-op conversion on the Game Boy, or one best ignored? Well, as anyone who's played the two titles can attest to, even from the off, the Game Boy port, strangely the only non-arcade version of the game to see the light of day, seems to have a lot more love and care put into it than the original. Gone are the single screens of text and static imagery to set the scenery in the arcade, say hello to animated cutscenes. I bet you've suddenly forgotten how bad that box art looks, right? Once the stage is set, the game provides a small tutorial on how to play that will see you through the rest of the game. As a ghost, hover over an enemy, press A or B, and possess them. While this doesn't work on bosses, you can possess enemies around the stages to enact murderous revenge to your heart's content. As a possessed enemy, you can press A to jump and B to fire, as you'd expect from most games like this. However, the real beauty of this system is that each enemy has their own unique strength, speed, jump height, and weapon type, meaning you can really switch up your playstyle on the fly to suit your preferred preferences. That is, as long as there's an enemy around for you to embody. See a fresh victim you'd like to possess? No problem. Just press the select button and re-enter your spirit form, causing the unanimated corpse you abandoned to slump to the ground in favour of your next victim. See, I told you not to be fooled by its charming exterior. The manual can say you're borrowing the bodies all at once, but even they're using air quotes. Of course, there are limitations to how much time you can spend out of a body and in one. As a ghost, you have an energy meter that simply acts as a timer for how long you can be out of a body, meaning sometimes you're just gonna have to grab whatever body comes to hand. Once you're inside a possessed host, you have a life bar that naturally depletes as you take hits from other enemies, and instantly drains if you fall into a spike trap. When you die in an enemy, you also lose a small segment of your energy bar, so be sure to switch out if you feel the odds aren't in your favour. Doing so will often even allow you the option of escaping a particularly tricky area if it's causing you trouble. You can also find vials of health and energy scattered around the levels to balance these meters back out. I will give you fair warning though. It is much better to try and keep your energy level higher than the corpse's health, as when you get to one of the game's 6 end level boss fights, it is the energy meter that will turn into your health bar for the encounter. And honestly, some of them can hit pretty hard and dying will see you restart the entire level. I will hand it to Jaleco though, not only do they give you unlimited continues, their game over screen is only rivaled with triples for cutest on the system, so at least it takes a little bit of the edge off. The game's 6 bosses, as mentioned, are all pretty unique encounters. One rises from the floor and shoots lasers, one's a giant crane, there's a snake that tries to kill you with projectiles, a cheap-ass slime monster who not only throws slime at you but also between phases rains down on you from above, a weird flying cyclops worm, and finally, the eye-patched, nameless mafia leader himself in his giant Dr. Wily-esque flying rubber duck. Yeah, this game goes places, Game Boys and girls, and honestly, I'm glad it does. It's pretty easy to focus on how messed up the game's premise is. Not only were you murdered in an attempt to extort a man for his life's work, but you're then trying to save your girlfriend by literally marching people to their deaths at the hands of, if not friends, colleagues at the very least. If the enemies were all gangsters, after a while, I guess you'd kind of forget about it. But as you get further into the game, you see vampires, ninjas, killer robots, and dragons that all not only sand the edges off the idea of possession, but really make the game feel incredibly light-hearted even. Honestly, for me at least, this is a masterclass in game design. Take a brilliant mechanic with somewhat questionable moral implications and put it against a backdrop of the bizarre to make it incredibly palatable. Bravo, CP Brain, you should take a bow. You'll also be happy to know that the game offers the player a good and a bad ending. One where you save the girl and one where you don't. At the end of the first level, you'll find a document not only informing you of where your girlfriend is being held, but that the cell she's imprisoned in requires 3 keys to open. While the game essentially gives you the first key, the second and third are harder to find. The second hidden behind an easily missable door, while the third key sees you having to activate switches scattered around a level to spell out the word ghost. Okay, this one is a little convoluted. But CP Brain gets a free pass because, well, the rest of the game. That, and they let you keep the keys after you die. On finding your girlfriend, you'll possess her body in order to kill the mafia boss and win the game. And well, she's the best character in the game, to be honest. She's fast, she can jump super high, and she's also packing a giant laser rifle, making the end boss a cinch, and making you question how she got kidnapped in the first place. There's also a bad ending, however, where you don't get the keys, and, well, she dies in the explosion of the mafia base, and your spirit fades away into nothingness. Yeah, man, it's rough. Overall, if you couldn't tell by just how much I have to say about this game, Avenging Spirit is fantastic. This port was actually made by a lot of the same internal Jaleco team who would go on to work on the Japanese-only sequel to Fortified Zone, Akara no Yoshai 2, and it shows. Despite some slowdown in the game's more hectic sections, Jaleco's in-house team was able to refine and polish the arcade version of the game perfectly for Nintendo's little handheld that could. The music is phenomenal. The graphics are amongst the best on the system, and more importantly, they fixed the jumping mechanics to make the platform a lot more manageable. One downside is that enemies will respawn if you go slightly off-screen, though it's balanced out by the fact that doing so will often reveal vials and more powerful enemy spawns behind you, something that I honestly don't think I've ever seen in a video game before. The game also genuinely has a lot of replay value due to a ton of hidden secrets in the levels, a variety of gameplay options available to the player with different enemy types, and if you're a real sadist, there's an expert mode of the game that can be unlocked by holding up A and B at the title screen. It throws harder enemies at the player, restricts the amount of vials, and probably makes for a miserable slime boss experience at the end of level 4. Do so at your own sadist pleasure, folks. However, the true horror story of Avenging Spirit is that it's a pretty rare game. I'm guessing at least partially due to most people judging the game by its terrible box art. Unfortunately, as with most rare Game Boy games, it's an incredible title and thus demands a high price. Fortunately though, just like Trip World, you can dust off your 3DS and get this one from the eShop. Huzzah! If you're looking for an incredible game to play this Halloween, I promise you, you can honestly not go wrong with Avenging Spirit. And that brings us to the end of another Boyographic, ladies and gentlemen. I hope you've enjoyed. If you have, please let me know in the comments down below on Twitter at GameBoyle, and check out some more of our videos. Until next week, where I'll be back with a sports title. Game on.